Welcome to Healthcare Du Jour, where we dish up and digest the latest in healthcare. For the next 30 minutes, sit back as we bring you insight, commentary, and discussion on trending topics to the table, all expertly served up by our host and his guests. Healthcare Du Jour is brought to you by Hightech Answers and Healthcare Now Radio, part of the Answers Media Network, and is sponsored by the law offices of Myrick O'Connell. Now here is your host, Matt Fisher.
Welcome back, and thank you for joining as we dive into the hottest topics in healthcare. I'm your host, Matt Fisher. On the menu today is Kapil Nair, co-founder and president of Bettera. Welcome, Kapil.
Oh, thank you, Matt. Really a pleasure to be here.
Well, it's great to have you on. And what I always like to do before getting into the main part of the discussion is allow my guests to give a little bit more of an introduction in terms of who they are and what they do. So please go ahead.
Great. I'm a technologist by heart. Fundamentally believe that technology is probably the best lever we have to kind of bend the cost curve challenge that we see in healthcare today. I'm also a co-founder of Bettera Health, where we focus on simplifying healthcare improvement. What that means is we help healthcare systems and hospitals by providing them tools necessary to integrate and monitor various safety and quality efforts, as well as, not just stops there, but it also helps with monitoring their culture and perceptions of culture towards safety and quality.
So you kind of started off by saying that you're a technologist at heart. So were you always interested in the healthcare field, or did that develop over time?
Oh, that's a great question. The single word answer to that is it's serendipity. Never wanted to be in healthcare, never thought of being in healthcare. But, right after I finished my undergrad, I was going to get ready to go to the financial engineering world, the Wall Street. And it was funny, my wise mother asked me a really strong question. She asked me if I wanted to create value or manipulate it. Let's go figure. And that ended up with a degree in health systems engineering from Georgia Tech. And then after that, I got into Cerner, one of the largest EMR companies, really enjoyed it and learned a lot. And here I am now after a few years with Bettera Health.
No, I think the serendipitous approach is actually a really great one to be able to pursue. It's fairly similar how I ended up focused on healthcare. Was the opportunity came by and figured out that I became really passionate about it. And I think when you have passion behind what you're doing, it makes the work more enjoyable, but I think you also become more invested in what you're doing and will pursue different ideas and really drive to help improve whatever system you're working on.
I completely agree. The fascinating thing about healthcare, I think, Matt, you probably have also noticed, it's really complex and it's adaptive. And when, for someone who's really thinking and is a systems thinker by nature, it's a great place. It's a great place to start. It's also a humbling place, right? Because since it's so complex, that you can't solve it on your own. It requires you to take a completely team-based approach, whether it's being a care provider or whether you are being in the technology side of things or the legal side of things like you are. So it's really interesting.
So kind of with that background, what are the particular areas within the healthcare industry that motivate you the most, and where are you focusing your efforts?
Today, we at Bettera, we are really using technology to help organizations improve safety and quality, healthcare provider organizations improve safety and quality. We see a lot of silos in terms of how we approach improvement, how we collect improvement-related data, how we use that data towards improvement actions. So that's where I'm focused today. In the past life, it was more focused around, how do we use the right kind of information? How do we bring the right kind of information to the right kind of context in terms of clinical workflows and adoption of those things? So the data management aspect of it, how we use the data. I don't really like the word data much because it actually kind of takes the purpose of the data behind it. Information might be a better word. That's where I have been focused on throughout my career.
So, and when you're talking about management, what does that actually mean?
It's interesting. It's really about how we collect and bring the right kind of data at the right context, at the right time, to the right user in the right format. So it's somewhat a combination of data and usability of that data, if you will, that interests me, interests or piques my interest. So if you look at fundamentally at healthcare, in healthcare, we have so many different streams of data, right? We have this consumeristic aspect of data around the patient information systems, as in, you know, all the clinical data that comes around with it, the payer data, the financial systems data, so much of all of this, right? And then, you know, most of the focus in healthcare has been around digitization of those efforts, if you will, but the second order effects around of that are somewhat missing. We have not truly, you know, harnessed all the power of this information that we can have in healthcare. So for example, I'll give you a quick example in the context of quality and safety improvement. The folks who are doing the work in a typical, let's say, a 300 bed hospital, the unit leader of the ICU who's trying to take care of the and their team, right? They're trying to take care of high risk patients who are in the ICU. They have, you know, from a quality management standpoint, they have to work on CODIs and ventilator associated infection or catheter associated infections and so forth. But all of these data streams that we push towards these frontline staff are all siloed, and what happens with that is the effectiveness of improvement methods or the effectiveness of adoption really decreases. So that's the part that, you know, we have to keep in mind as technologists or as people who are building solutions towards it. How will this be usable? How can we bring this to value in a way that it simplifies the work they're actually doing? What whose work are we simplifying, if you will?
Yeah, so thinking about the healthcare industry, are there any unique challenges that healthcare presents to those, you know, kind of usability and simplification efforts?
Yes, I mean it's really yes. That's a great question, and I think it depends on the context of where you're answering that question. I think a lot of it's cultural. So, for example, U.S. in the stoic, the stoicism and the individualism that we have in our culture has created silos of its own nature, right? But then if you look at, you know, socialized medicine, that's completely different. So the fundamental question. The root of all of this stems from whether we treat this as a right or whether it's actually a commodity, healthcare is a commodity or not. So there is that philosophical aspect, but when you start looking at how we think about data, we also see silos in terms of, you know, the collection mechanisms. And part of it is nature of how these businesses have to operate. You can't integrate financial data. You can't collect the same financial data the same way as you collect the patient information or clinical data, but we have to figure out a way to integrate and integrate to provide the right context. And that, I think that is the biggest challenge we will see when you start harnessing all of these all this data that we have in healthcare. And going back to the point of usability, that's also the ability to use this data to drive outcomes in the right way is also a fundamental challenge.
Yeah, it's interesting. It kind of a few times, I think you've talked about the siloed nature of the different data streams. You know, is that kind of nature of, you know, the broken apart pieces reflective of, I think, as you said, trying to digitize old streams of data, or is it something that the system is otherwise encouraging? You know, and using that as a backdrop, what do you think needs to be done to help break down those silos and really create a cohesive data set that can then be interpreted and rendered into a usable format?
That's a great question, and the way you have to think about it is it's the incentives, right? We are a complex adaptive system. The incentives that we have for providers versus patients versus payer systems are totally different, right? Unless we can align incentives in a form that will actually help these different blocks, if you will, to come together, we will still have the challenge of, you know, streamlining all of these activities together. Just look at a great example of price transparency issue that we have going on right now, right? The past couple of days, we saw a lot of news around that. There are factions and organizations or groups that are against it and for it. So again, that goes back to the fundamental nature of why some of these incentives are misaligned. And part of it is also about, you know, for example, another good example is we have metric glut. We collect data for just collection of data. I think it was Don Borwick who actually coined this term, metric glut. And we went back and looked at it at Betterra, and I think it was my partner who came up with this number. As we looked into the data from CMS in 2012, we had 43 quality measures that we had to measure or report to. And today in 2019, we have about 760 or so. I don't remember the exact number, but it was the take was 10 metric on an average per every month for straight 6 years. So the two aspects that I said, one around the incentive structure, that's a fundamental systemic issue. But then also there is an issue of actual implementation of how we want to collect and how we want to use this data. How many organizations would be able to go after 10 new metric a month? I have never heard of any industry that creates that many number of new metric every month.
Yeah, that term metric glut, I had not heard that before, but I would fully agree that it is something that is presenting a major challenge to healthcare, because you know, you're referencing the hundreds of different quality measures that an organization might need to be trying to track is, you know, something that I've discussed with others in the past. And it's, you know, at some point you have to question then what is actually the definition of quality. And, you know, kind of using that hope, what is probably a nearly impossible question to answer, you know, would be interested in getting your perspective on what does quality mean from your point of view?
That's it's a tough question. You're going to put me on the spot here. The answer to that is it depends, because, you know, the definition of quality, if you were to ask a provider, a physician, might be completely different from the definition of quality if you ask a patient who is the consumer. I think the lack of common terminology or coming together in terms of these definitions create challenges in healthcare, because, you know, I honestly, Matt, don't have a good definition for what quality means in healthcare, which would be a broad spectrum, which could be applied in a broad spectrum way. I think that the challenge here is the literacy aspect, right? The definition of quality, the meaning and the definition of quality that applies to one stakeholder versus the other in healthcare is very different. And we always ask, at what cost? We can provide the best quality of care, but at what cost? So that balancing act is where, you know, we will have to find some medium ground and probably, hopefully, at some point, come to a common format definition, if you will.
No, I think that's a great point. And, you know, having you start the answer with it depends is, you know, an answer that I'm very used to giving, because from the legal perspective, it's that you know, it's kind of one of the first things you're taught in law school is you can answer almost every question that way, because, you know, the perspectives and the facts are going to change what the answer could be. And for those of you just joining, I'm talking with Kapil Nair from Betterra, and we've been talking about data management and now starting to get into what does quality mean. And, you know, other than the fact that you just said, you know, the answer depends, I think one of the most important things that I heard you say was it's the reason it depends is because it depends on which perspective you're looking at it from. And it very frequently feels that when you're talking about quality, it's only, you know, again, you're talking about in a siloed manner. You're only looking at it from either the provider perspective or a government payer perspective or a commercial payer perspective or the patient. You're never trying to bring, or you're not frequently trying to bring all those together to try and get a cohesive viewpoint on quality.
That's right and fair. And I think, you know, this is where the aspect of culture really starts to play, right? And it's not just the worldwide view of culture, but also the organizational view of culture starts to play a good part. You know, we work with a lot of lot of the healthcare leaders, one of the things that we constantly see is the divergence of viewpoints about not just the definitions of quality and safety, but also how they view each of these different aspects around, you know, the norms and attitudes towards this. And we at Bettera we call it the leadership gap. Usually what we tend to see is leaders having a higher perspective on the quality of care or the safety efforts that is going on in the organization than the front line. And that gap is one of the fundamental barriers that we see towards not only alignment, but also towards improvement, if you will.
And that's very interesting. And it's, I hate to do this, but I want to shift the conversation in what might end up being a different direction. But you keep talking about quality and safety, which at least to me is suggesting that you see a difference between the two. So kind of from your perspective, what are you contemplating when you're talking about safety, and then how does that correlate to quality?
Matt, this is an interesting question. If you go to the technical definitions of safety and quality, it might be different, but where you could say safety has to do with lack of harm or trying to figure out how we provide a place where there is near zero harm or zero harm, even though it's a journey. And quality is where we do it all with effectiveness and efficiency and making sure that the best practices are adopted to you know, the technical aspects of providing care and so forth. But I think Don Barwick, I think it was in 2018 or 2019, IHI conference nailed this very well. Separating the quality and safety moments are not, it's really not good. And placing them in, you know, in these different dimensions, I think it was the word that he used, placing them in these separate dimensions is a mistake. Ultimately, we in healthcare have to drive improvement in an integrated way, and the way we do it by reducing the silos, the way we do it by is integrating all these different efforts together as much as we can, so that we can bring true joy to the frontline provider who is actually doing the work of improvement. So that's kind of my take on this, if you will.
No, and I think as you're saying, kind of a compression of the ideas makes sense, because arguably, if you're able to improve the quality, which means improve the manner and how you're delivering care, improve the efficiency, that should result in a safer delivery of care, because then you've provided what is being viewed as better care, and you know, theoretically having better outcomes, and you know, if you can be able to catch issues or either before they happen or in an earlier stage, you know, that can help improve the outcome for the individual, which in turn, you know, maybe exposes them to fewer tests or procedures, which, you know, also makes it safer. So it's, you know, it really does seem like, as you're suggesting, it's all within the same dimension and it all flows together, and you really, you know, either can't or should not be trying to tease it apart and looking at it in different components.
And ultimately, this exercise is all about providing the right kind of care for the patient in the right context of the patient, right at the right venue, if you will. And the interesting part about this, you know, ultimately, when it comes to the operationalization aspect, the challenge that we see today is, see, the quality and safety professionals who are in healthcare organizations, who are the champions of these efforts, who are the, you know, the people who distribute best practices and so forth, are not the ones who are doing the actual work of quality and safety improvement. The ones who are doing the actual work of quality and safety improvement is that frontline nurse who is providing the care to that patient. And when we start to make these theoretical distinctions, it's good from a academic pursuit standpoint, but from the actual implication of it, the way we want to do the things, the way we want to perfect things, that divergence doesn't really help much. And that's where the crux of why I believe that Dr. Barwick said that the mistake of separation of these two brings a bigger challenge, if that makes sense.
No, it definitely does. And, you know, as you were just describing, you have that, as you said, the separation between the individuals or the groups that are arguably creating these metrics and the ones who are then actually charged with implementing them. So what could be done to help integrate those two groups of people so that way you're getting the kind of academic theory side of things informed by the practical real world application of it, and hopefully if you can bridge those two worlds, end up with a better place to start from.
I think that's if you are asking from an organizational standpoint, I think there are two aspects to it, right? There's a policymaker aspect to it, which is far beyond something that I can just say, hey, this is what they need to do, because ultimately healthcare policy depends, a lot of it depends upon unfortunately it depends upon the political spectrum you are on, or which side of the bench is ruling the country, and what the vision for healthcare looks like. But I would say that at least for organizations, from a usability and implementation standpoint, culture is probably the best vehicle to bridge that gap, finding sensitivity towards the method. There's this concept in reliability engineering called sensitivity towards operations. Finding that if senior leaders and quality and safety professionals can actually find the sort of sensitivity towards the day-to-day operations of that frontline nurse or doctor, that's where you are starting to bridge that gap. From a policymaker standpoint, it's a much broader question. I think there will be academic exercises involved in that, but I can tell one thing, that we can slash the number of, if we can just do one thing and slash the number of metrics, quality and safety metrics that we have, and help organizations get beyond check the box mentality. Hey, I need to report 10 of these metrics this year because that's what my VBP is based on, or my reimbursement is based on. If we can go beyond that, that's where goodness will start to happen. It's what I believe from a policy standpoint.
Yeah, no, I definitely fully support trying to get beyond a check the box approach to things, because it's actually interesting. That ties to a comment that my wife made to me the other day. So she's a primary care physician and she has to live with these metrics. And she was saying sometimes she just shakes her head about it and, honestly says to a patient, "I just need you to do this because otherwise I'm going to get dinged for not hitting a metric," even though, the patient then says, "But that's really all on me, the patient. You're doing what you're supposed to. So, why would you get dinged?" And I think that goes back to the conversation we were having, which is all these things are siloed. It's, you're not bringing everyone to the table.
Right, and I think the piece that is interesting to me here is you are fundamentally devaluing that provider, right? Taking the joy away from all of this. We have two big issues in healthcare right now, at least in my eye, from a systemic standpoint. Our care providers, our doctors and nurses, are not happy. Are not happy today. And we are stealing the joy from their work. There has been so many articles that you see. It's almost feels like a national epidemic, and that's not good. And that's just not good, because we are forcing them. We are taking them away from the things that are important to them. That's actually be part of the healing of a patient or a group of patients whom they are caring for. And the second, go ahead, Matt.
Oh, no, go ahead. The only thing I was going to say is, to that point, it seems like if you're taking away from that joy, you're taking away from the ability to actually provide high quality care.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I don't think high quality care is made in algorithms. High quality care is made by best practices. Of course, there is an aspect of best practice and so forth, but it's by that touch of that doctor and the nurse who is attentive and has the time to provide the kind of care that the patient and the family desires.
No, that is exactly right. It's I think that's one of the best statements I've heard is, care is not going to come from an algorithm. It is from that human interaction, and it just you get the sense that all too often that is being overlooked because so many hopes nowadays are pinned upon technology.
Right. And I think this is it's funny because you asked me who I am, and I said, you know, I'm a healthcare technologist by heart. I think if we lose the aspect of empathy in all of this, we are just doing it for the sake of doing. And I think what we are seeing is, you know, we have some structural issues in our healthcare system. We don't need to go in depth on that because that could go for another 20 hours. But if we actually don't solve some of these fundamental issues that we are seeing from a provider standpoint, the challenges that they are facing, or even, you know, those could be some of that, those could be solved, right? Some of those could be solved by technology. So if we had the right technology, if we are using some of you know, the latest and greatest, not all latest and greatest, but carefully curated latest and greatest, we could bring time back to these providers. We could do things that are more helpful for them.
You know, and it definitely seems like the ultimate message there is let's achieve a balance and recognize where the value and where opportunity to work together should be coming from. But believe it or not, we're already out of time. I want to thank my guest, Kapil Nair, for a great conversation today.
Well, thanks, Matt. I really enjoyed it as well.
Yeah, no, it's great to have you on. And as you said, we easily could go into many other topics. So we'll have to keep that in mind and look for future opportunities. And thank you to everyone listening. Keep the dialogue going and connect with me at hashtag HCDEJURE. I'm Matt Fisher. Until next time.